properties and people to live in very small units. Because of the government's, what the government is doing on welfare changes, I think we have to be cognizant of that. I think we have to be very mindful when we get applications like this that we make them as robust as possible. And I think from the comments we've heard so far that, you know, a lot of the committee members don't feel that's the case. I'm going to start off though by saying something positive about this application, and it's just in relation to, you know, again, the issue I've raised many times in the past about cycle storage and parking. That this is exactly what I would want to see in terms of that particular issue, that the pre-application letter which Stuart referred to does specifically ask the applicant to make a robust application in terms of cycle storage, and they have actually done that, so we don't have to actually put a condition about cycle parking. So that said, I'll get on to the many negative things I want to say, really. Again, like Stuart has already referred to, I read through this pre-application advice, and I didn't understand when I read the clear advice about all habitable rooms facing north or east. When we look at the plans, we see bedroom 6 is not facing north or east. So there's a clear breach of the advice in that specific regard. Now, my main concern with regard to the layout is really the first floor, where you've got 5 very small bedrooms, including one which at 6.5 metres squared, I think, is right on the limit of anything. We don't have any specific specifications to work to. That really is, you know, that really is right on the limit. And, you know, 5 bedrooms for 1 bathroom, as has already been said, is really pushing it. One thing I asked for, now I haven't been given a copy of a late list, I don't know if anybody else has, but I did ask for a specific condition relating to the number of residents that would be, the maximum number of residents that would be allowed. First of all, we confirm that that has been applied as a condition, and my question really is, if we were to reject this application, and if it was overturned on appeal, would that condition then fall, that the applicant would be able to kind of put more than 10 people in? I'm not asking that question as a reason to kind of accept this application. I certainly intend to vote against it, but I am interested as to whether on appeal, if it would overturn that condition before.
Thank you, Chair. We have applied the condition that you asked for. It reads, the residential occupancy of the building, subject of this permission, shall at any one time be limited to 10 people. And the reason for that is to ensure a satisfactory standard of accommodation having regard to the communal facilities to be provided, specifically to bathroom, toilet and kitchen facilities, and to comply with policy HS14 of the Wirral Unitary Development Plan. We have used that condition elsewhere, most notably, I think, and most recently at the Queen's Hotel, opposite the Ned Park. And that was defended at appeal.
But my other question is, if we reject this and it was overturned on appeal, what would happen to that condition? It wouldn't exist, would it?
Well, as part of the appeal process, we would have to provide a statement to the inspectorate, and as part of that process, we would identify a list of draft conditions that we would ask the inspector to consider, and ultimately it would be for the inspector to decide whether or not he attached conditions that we'd asked for.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anybody else? Bill?
Thank you, Chair. Just very, very briefly, I attended the site visit, and I was appalled to see the size of the building. Just to illustrate that point, I just want to say that I've had friends who have been unfortunate to be placed in bedsits of just like what's being proposed. And frankly, it only takes one bad egg within that building and it becomes absolutely hellhole within it and around it. I'm grateful in a sense it's been put before me because most of my life I've looked forward to being in a position to reject a proposal just like this for using everyone I've seen.
Jean Stapleton.
Thanks, Chair. I didn't go on the site physical. I know the area very, very well. I've lived in the area a number of years ago. This is an area that needs to be supported by... Sorry, what were you saying?
That's everybody's
line. Oh, sorry. It's an area that needs to be supported with good quality housing. And indeed, there are some good quality housing being built in the area. And it's lifting the whole environment. But this, I can see this becoming a potential slum in a few years. We shouldn't be allowing this sort of development in an area that
at the counter saying, oh, there's 11 in tonight, and we haven't got the staff. Our staff here are down to the bare bones because of the outrageous difficulties, but we struggle, and we put these conditions in because I think sometimes we give it to Placata, and we may have a debate later on earlier about some conditions and some areas where we set things that we can't possibly enforce. And I think that would be a condition that we could like to insist on. But what if every resident decided that night that they were going to have their partner around, we can't enforce issues like that. My view is that we shouldn't be encouraging this development somewhere. I'm looking forward to get that structure for all the minutes.
Stuart, Pat just wanted to come in with something.
Just to respond to that, I mean, I accept the difficulty of enforcing conditions. I think we all do. You get conditions on every single application. Enforcing them all is problematic, to say the least. I think it's important we send a statement that, we think if that thing goes ahead, that there should be a maximum number of people living there. Okay, living there. Now they can invite whoever they want around for the night, I guess, now and again. How many people are going to be there? I think it's right that we put a condition on there to show that that's a concern.
If I may, before we worry about conditions, then I'm happy to test with you and the committee on a reason for refusal. just before we move on, often for us, because HMOs are licensable, and as luck would have it, hopefully other councillors in the room have had concerns, and it might be policy issues for other departments as opposed to the planning department that would be more appropriate to enforce the concerns that they've had and Steve have raised. Nonetheless, Chair, let me try this by the committee. To refuse the application, having regards to the number of bedrooms proposed, the property is considered to be of insufficient size to accommodate the proposed development. The development would result in an over-intensive use of the property by creating 10 bedrooms for which, given the potential number of occupants, the proposed number of washing and toilet facilities, in particular with regard to the first floor bedrooms, is considered to be inadequate, resulting in a standard of accommodation that the council considers will be substandard, contrary to the objectives of policy HS14 of the Rural Region Development Plan and the principles of the National Planning Policy Framework, which seeks to ensure high quality accommodation and a good standard of amenity for all future occupants of land.
Okay, do we have a second then? Yeah,
the site to the west sits entirely within the primary residential area,
principle of new housing is acceptable subject to the provisions of policy HS4, new housing development. Proposal HS1 in the UDP allocates sites for new housing development in the period from April 1993 to March 2001 and identifies 60 units for that part of the site that falls within the housing allocation. The number of units identified in the proposed layout for this part of the site is 91, which is higher than that identified in the UDP proposal. However, the UDP was adopted in February 2000 and is now some 17 years old, and there has been considerable raft of changes in national and at times regional planning policies which addresses the issue of housing densities. Density figures per se are not specified in the National Planning Policy Framework, which says that the planning system should seek to maximise the use of land and deliver sustainable development within a high quality environment. The development would equate to approximately 28 dwellings per hectare across the 4.27 hectare site. This is considerably lower than the density of the developed area to the north along Croft Drive and beyond. There are a number of trees along the northern boundary of the site and within the site itself. The site is not subject to a tree preservation order, and as such, trees are not subject to any statutory protection. However, as part of the proposals, landscaping details will be brought forward that will introduce new planting and, where possible, retain existing trees, particularly along the site perimeters. A detailed drainage strategy has also been submitted, which has been considered in detail by the Leeds Local Flooding Authority, who have raised no objections subject to that strategy being implemented and maintained, and this element of the proposal is secured by condition. The scale of the development triggers the requirement for affordable housing, and a viability statement has been submitted. The applicants have outlined that affordable housing can be provided on site as discounted market units for sale. However, the council's preferred option is affordable homes for rent, which would help meet an identified need for those on the council's waiting list. The viability statement outlines that on-site affordable housing rent is not financially viable, and this is backed up by an independent review of the proposals on behalf of the council. Therefore, in agreement with housing colleagues, it is proposed to enable off-site provision by way of a commuted sum through a 106 agreement that will allow the council to meet its identified needs for affordable homes for rent. The Section 106 would also secure speed reduction lanes along Manor Road or Sandbrook Lane, which will allow for traffic to be slowed down along this stretch of the road. Noise reduction measures will be employed across the site with suitable acoustic design measures, such as an upgraded specification of glazing and acoustic fencing, ensure properties, particularly at the southern and eastern parts of the site, are not subject to noise disturbance by proximity to the M53 spur and adjacent highway. The proposed development will result in a high-quality residential development that makes efficient use of land and contributes significantly towards the borough's housing figure. The scheme is recommended for approval. There is no petition or objection in connection with this development.
Thank you, Matthew.
Good
morning, Councillor. So,
I'll hand
it over to the committee. Treena?
Thanks, Chair. Yes, I am a ward councillor, and I welcome the development of the erection of the 122 units. There's lots of things that I do welcome about this. The retention of the existing boundary trees, the hedgerows, planted around the perimeter to create an attractive environment and buffer for the existing houses adjacent to this site. I also welcome the strategic housing services offer to secure the Section 106 legal agreement for affordable housing provision to provide a percentage of those units for rent, not sale, to meet the housing needs of those people who are on the registered council wait list. There's just one thing that I'd like to ask the planning officer if he could give us some assurance on, and that is the flood risk assessment and the drainage management strategy. There is two locations on the site that are at risk, high risk of surface water flooding. So, you know, as a ward councillor, Anita and both myself have had many dealings with United Utilities and the Highways Agency over drainage issues on Upton Park, which is directly opposite the site, and the M53 motorway. So, if the planning officer could give us some assurances as to those assessment and strategy plans, that would be great. Just finally, if I could just say, While we welcome the provision of the speed reduction measures along Manor Drive, I am disappointed, despite local residents and local councillors' representations for a 20-mile-an-hour zone, traffic calming measures are not being considered for Prof Drive. This is already used as a cut-through to Upton Road, and this development will undoubtedly bring a further increase in traffic through Prof Drive, and I would just like to have that noted that we are disappointed in that. So if you could give some assurances to the risk assessment, flood risk assessment and the drainage management strategy.
Thank you, through you, Chair. United Utilities have obviously appraised this proposal as well, and as you can see from page 42 on your papers, they've raised no objections to the application, subject to conditions, and the conditions are detailed in the report. In addition to that, a quite detailed flood risk assessment and drainage strategy was submitted by the applicant as part of these proposals, and that's been reviewed by our flood engineers, who we call the lead local flood authority, and they're happy with the details that are set out in that strategy, provided that the scheme is developed in accordance with that strategy. And as I said in my presentation, there are conditions that tie the development into that strategy, so that it is built in accordance with that. So I think with those measures in place, we're satisfied, I think, that the scheme won't result in any flooding. And I think, as I said on site, there's also a pumping station that's proposed in the bottom right-hand corner of the site on your plan.
Thanks, Jeff. We just have Councillor Johnson rightly mentioned the problems of speeding on Croft Drive. Can the highways officer tell us why Croft Drive is not being built?
Thank you, through you, Chair. The likely traffic generation from this proposal is something around during peak hours, going to be around 70 to 75 vehicles an hour. Obviously, they're not all going to go towards Croft Drive. There's going to be some distribution around the network. When we look at distribution routes, the view is that the volume that's actually going to use Croft Drive is going to be very low, potentially 12 to 15 in the peak hour, that sort of number. So with that low number, I think it's difficult to justify traffic calming or additional speed reduction measures or 20-mile-an-hour speed limit in Croft.
Thanks, Chair. I think the authority received, was it £5 million in response to the sale of this fund, Mr. Chair, if you remember? £5 million? Just for information, the £5 million that we obtained by the sale of this fund? Okay, I understand that, just to put it into context, and this was council land that we disposed of through various means and various ways, obtaining the eviction of the existing tenants. And for this property, this now land actually sold for around £5 million. It's disappointing that A, the developer couldn't be persuaded to put in traffic calming measures on Croft Drive, because as we know, most of the land, most of the sites near motorways, people choose to live there if they have easy access to the motorways. And that includes Croft Drive, which is the nearest way to get to the motorway. So that's a disappointment. Perhaps Matthew can confirm the number of affordable units that are likely to be built. And the amount is, I think, that's set aside in 116.
Through you, Chair. If on-site provision was to be brought forward, then it would be 24 units out of the 122. But as I detailed in my presentation, and as it's detailed in the report, there isn't to be any on-site provision. It's off-site provision for affordable rent. And I think it has been agreed with the applicant to bring that forward. I'm not sure is it appropriate to say that there is any that figure is still subject to the negotiations around the Section 106 agreement. So it wouldn't really be appropriate to say what it is at this stage.
Right. That's because it hasn't been signed up yet.
Right.
Just a very quick question, really. What's on this site visit? The site is obviously incredibly noisy, as we saw it on the morning when we went there. Just wondering from the environmental officer whether there's been any
two-storey side extension and a single-storey rear extension. The two-storey extension will be in line with the existing front and rear elevations and would have a lower ridge height and setback at first floor by 1 metre. Although supplementary planning guidance note 11 on house extension seeks to provide for a 1 metre separation at boundaries, there is nothing in planning policies that prevents development being built up to the boundary line. Indeed, there are countless examples of where this has been done across the borough, and the lower ridge and first floor setback ensures terracing effect would not result. A similar extension at 39 Ashley Road has been approved, and also at 63 Ashley Road, both involved two-storey side extensions. The single-storey extension will have a roof that slopes away from the neighbouring property at 53 Ashley Road. Whilst this property has a small kitchen to the side with a single window that would face the two-storey extension, the movement of the sun around the backs of these properties, together with the reduction to single-storey of the extension at the rear of the application property, would ensure the window will not be overshadowed. This could be seen by members who attended the site visit on Tuesday from the extension at 39 Ashley Road, where members were able to see the extent of shadowing taking place. The extensions are fully compliant with policy HS11 for house extensions and are recommended for approval. There is a qualifying petition of objection.
Thank you, Matthew. Would the lead petitioner like to come forward to speak on this? No?
I'm here to represent the
Okay, so you're here, so all council would you like to come forward then, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. Councillor Mike Sullivan. I'd like to thank the committee as well and the Chair for coming on Tuesday to have a look at the house concern, the neighbouring house, where the objections come from. Can I start by just stating, Chair, for the benefit of the housing officer, it was felt that the plans were extremely vague, and although scale is stated, there was no scale bar attached to the plan, which does make it a bit difficult. So, could you bear that in mind, Matthew, please?
The plans were scaled, Councillor.
I'm just passing on the objector's notes that there was no scale bar,
okay.
Which would help the future reference. From the given proposed plans and measurements taken at the site, this two-storey side extension and single-storey rear extension, using the identified 1.5-metre scale, appears to be 2.5 metres sideways from the existing building line. This would bring the building line up to 5 centimetres from the boundary line. This measurement between each side elevation and the two properties This measurement between the side elevation of the two properties and the boundary wall is only 1.8 metres, but this is not indicated on the plans, which also do not indicate the new build. It's not set back a full 2 metres from the existing front elevation. This contravenes Wirral's HS11 housing extension policy 2015 on several points, which states that any two-storey side extension to semi-detached houses should be set back at least 1.5 metres from the common boundary line to avoid the effect of terracing, or 1 metre from the front of the existing property and 1 metre from the boundary wall. The plans do not adhere to either of these, so this application is against HS11, the way we look at it. HS11 does not refer to the roofline with regard to the terracing effect, but rather the distance of the first story wall from the boundary wall. If the building with the current plans is permitted, there would be a two-story wall 1.8 metres away from the kitchen and the rear door. This is against HS11 building regulations. If this building application is permitted, and this was discussed on Tuesday, Chair, if this was permitted, any future application application from number 53 Ashley Road for a similar extension would be refused because it would create terracing. It would create a terracing effect. The proposed extension is inappropriate to the size of the plot. As HS 11 indicates, any extension or any new build, there are regulations there which state if it does have adverse effects on the people next door, as people who attended the site visit, it will have a great effect on number 53. And it was also pointed out that there's been two extensions in Ashley Road of a similar nature. But what I would like to point out is every plan that comes in is based on its own merits. So we have got precedents, of course we have right around the body. But this one, and the people who attended the site visit, have seen how tiny this kitchen is. And I'd like to point out that both of the extensions which the planning officer has pointed out, the adjoining property, both of those properties have had extensions to the kitchen, and they've also got windows on the extensions which would bring the light in. And as the committee saw on Tuesday, there's only one window. This is the existing kitchen, and it's been there since the 1930s when these properties were built. It's a tiny kitchen, it's a tiny window, and whatever the planning department says, this will have a detrimental effect on the people who live in number 53. And it's been pointed out to me that it's not only the kitchen that will suffer loss of light, but also the bedroom upstairs and the bathroom. So I would appeal to the committee to reject this, and you've got grounds to reject it on HS 11. So that's it, Chair, and I would hope that people who came to the site visit on Tuesday bear in mind what I said earlier. Thank you, Chair. Thanks, committee.
Thanks, Mike. As you quite rightly pointed out, each application is decided on its own merits. The council mentioned, Matthew, that there is contravening HS 11 policy. Could you just comment on that?
I am sorry to do this to Councillor Sullivan, but he's misinterpreted policy HS 11. What it actually says for 2.5 metres off the boundary is if the rear extension, so the rear extension, not the side extension, if the rear extension is two-storey, then it should be set 2.5 metres off the parking boundary. The rear extension is single-storey, so that part of policy HS 11 does not apply. What he said about where the two-storey extension should be set back at least 1.5 metres from the common boundary, or 1 metre at first floor, and that is what is achieved here. The boundary, this element of the two-storey extension is pushed back 1 metre at first floor, and that's to avoid a terracing effect. So, as I say, I must apologise to Councillor Sullivan, but he has misinterpreted policy HS 11, and it is fully compliant with the policy in the UK.
Okay,
I'm
going to open this up to committee comments.
Thank you, Chair. Matthew, could you comment on whether the tenant effect would be created if residents in number 53 were to have a similar extension?
The purpose of having the, so if we look at this part of the plan down here, so the purpose of having the lower ridge on the extension and setting it back at first floor level, it's twofold, the reason really. The first is to ensure that the extension is subordinate to the host property, but also if number 53 were to do the same thing, and they followed the policy as well, so they have a lower ridge height and they set it back at first floor level, it wouldn't read as a terrace, because if it had a continuation of the ridge and it was all brought forward so the building line continued, it would effectively read as a terrace of four rather than two sets of semi-detached properties.
that, I know that this NHS 11 that was mentioned on the site of living by these were guidelines. I appreciate that, and that impacted on my mind. I considered it for some time. Then a few days ago, we received an email with regards to a review that taking place. Now, I don't want to go too much about it. I'm trying to paint a picture of what has led to my career impact. So, quite a long story short, sorry.
Can I just say that different applications here, wall counselling, yourself, I just think we need to stick to the application.
Fair enough, let me rephrase. I know of previous applications that were used on NHS 11 where the inspector has agreed for counselling to dismiss that appeal. It happens quite regularly. There's even an example like a site which I learned very recently. That being the case, I have a statement. I do think even the other examples that are on the street, I think they're over there, and I think they probably are in development. But my concern arises that I'm just looking at the rules, and HS11 doesn't appear like it's been satisfied in this instance. I don't know how I can stop these types of sins, what I deem as mainly exceptions. I just don't know.
Matthew would just like to explain the issue on the side window.
Okay. I appreciate that some members were on site and some members weren't. For those of you who were on the site, we looked at number 39, and at that time of the day, and taking into account the time of year, so it's winter, so the sun is lower in the sky, so at other times of the year the sun is going to be higher in the sky, but you have to take into account when we're looking at these types of applications, the orientation and the way that the sun moves when it rises and sets. So in this instance, the sun will rise and it will travel around the backs of these properties. So the sun will always be at the backs of these properties. So essentially the gardens will be in sunlight. But for those of you who are on the site on Tuesday, when we looked at number 29, you could see the extent of shadowing at or around 11:15. And the kitchen window on the side of number 53 will not be shaded at that time of the day. As the sun moves around, that window will become shaded, but it will become shaded by its own property, not by the extension, because it will move behind number 53. So the impact of the extension is minimal, as it were, because that window is shaded by itself, in essence, because of the way the sun travels around.
Just to add to that, there was a brick stall behind the kitchen, and that's what Matthew is referencing when we saw that on site. Treena, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I did attend the site visit on Tuesday, and I feel so sorry for this poor resident. She's in the late 80s, tiny little galley kitchen with a small window, and she doesn't want to be looking out every day at this big, massive, extension next door, but the planning officers have said that it's compliant with HS 11. Would it stand up to appeal? And obviously, I'd like to hear what other members have to say about this, but my heart breaks for this poor resident, it really does. She's in the late 80s, that's all I need to say.
David?
Yeah, I also went on the site visit, and I totally agree with you, Treena. I'm very sorry for that lady who has to live in these circumstances. If you look at the detail of where the window actually is, Matthew is correct. That extension next door would not actually impact on the light she's already getting from where it's coming from. And my concern
regs that we currently have and use those to all our means. And I think if we could, in this case, use those rules and policies to help the residents, I think there was a great deal of sympathy from the site visit. But I think David's hit the nail on the head. I don't think there is Cantwell's chance, quite frankly, of using even our current policies, which are becoming outdated as we speak. But the other side of the coin is, of course, where we have a housing shortage and housing need, one of the reactions to that is altering the property that you currently live in to suit your circumstances. So people extend rather than being able to go and buy a new property of larger size. So the complications of the housing policy and everything end up with this raw sort of issue of where we have to make a decision one way or the other. But I think we have to be recognizant of it as a planning committee in the future of what the future housing needs are. At the moment, we will use the rules of the regs that we are blessed with and given here. But my view is that we can't really test this particular resident and concern changes in the regs we have. So, am I permitted to move the group?
I think Phil wants to speak. Phil, do you want to come
up? Thank you, Jed. Steve makes good points at the beginning and certainly to Treena. And there is another side to this story. There's clearly someone who lives in that house who wants to extend it for whatever, probably very, very good reason. And I completely agree that, you know, when you've got the option, you should extend that, not just buy a house. You know, it's the option is there. I've said that, you know, it's not one extension fits all. There was always an option to extend it in such a fashion in consultation with the resident next door. That was not going to impact or perceived impact on it indeed whatsoever, and that wasn't assumed. I just have that as a side of what's just been said. That being the case, I still think it's a little better. I'm gonna beg committee's indulgence. I'm gonna try and remove refusal. I'll try and then the room see how they feel. If it falls, so be it. Do I have permission? Thank you.
Well, the flag goes, we then also lose.
Well, okay, so. The Vell proposed, in particular, two-story side extension by reason of its side, scale, settings, depth, and height, would create an unmainly and over-dominant form of development, which would result in a significant loss of light to the side kitchen window number 53 Ocean Road. The development would therefore, contrary to the policy, HS 11 and World New Entry Development Plan and Supplementary Planning Guidance Note 11 housing extension.
and their relationship with one another, and also having regard to existing property